late to have Cathy Carroll, who was our past president, tell us thing about her arcing adventure, the creation of John Franklin's. So anyway, I hope you're all tired, shoveling and snowing and getting ready to snow around your house. So anyway, we usually have, for people that don't know me, I'm Dave Hickey, I'm president of the New Planet Labrador. I think they don't know me, but just introduce myself. We usually have these presentations throughout the winter over the years. We usually have maybe four or five, sometimes six of these presentations. This is the second one. We have two more lined up. The next one will be on March 6th. And Laura Knight, who is a member of the board of Pavlovar, she's currently in the process, her and a traveling partner, Jordy Allen Newman, are in the process of circumnavigating Newfoundland. And they're going, going from St. John's, and they're going around to the north and around Northern Peninsula and coming back. They're doing that in legs every summer, so many weeks of summer. So she's got so much done now. So on March the 6th, she will be doing the presentation on her work that's done so far. And then on March the 20th, Neil Burgess, who is also a family friend, and he's also into archaeology, and he will be telling us about a trip that he did to Harbor Proper, which is a very settled community in Central Bay, and he's going to be talking about that. So I will invite you all to attend this presentation. Anyway, it gives me great pleasure to introduce Cathy, and she's going to tell you all about her Arctic adventures. Both past two summers or past two fall?
Past two falls.
Past two falls. Anyway, take away Cassie's.
Okay, first of all, this one is just the first summer, which is 2022. But I also just went to the last one. But before I even start, thanks for coming. Freezing night. I know everybody likes to settle down after summer, but thanks for getting up and coming out. It's a big effort. And I also almost don't want to break this myth, but I'd love for you to continue to. Some people think that I just did this totally by kayak from, but I was actually the kayak guide on the cruise ship. So even my family, I'd send them a screenshot of, the little blue dot halfway across the Davis Strait from Greenland to Baffin Island. This is where I am, and they think I'm kayaking. I almost didn't want to step straight on that. Okay, so this is with Adventure Canada, and before I even start, anything I say is not the opinions of Adventure Canada, or what is just my own personal experience of working with Adventure Canada. So, I went from Greenland across to Copperline, and this past fall, it was Greenland down the Labrador coast, and then circumnavigating Newfoundland. And that was pretty awesome too. So I get to do all the fun spots without the hard breaking or anything in between. So we get to pick our spots, pick our conditions, and pick where we want to go. It was an incredible adventure because it's not just about, the paddling itself is incredible, amazing, just because of where you are, but the people, the culture, the history, and even the people you work with, all a huge package of an awesome adventure. So ask any questions you want to. Does anybody have any experience up in the northwest with Arctic? Yeah. And even with Canada, right? Yeah. Anybody else have any connections with the Great White North? So I can be lying and not. Okay, so journey through the Northwest Passage. Started in Toronto, and then everybody that was, it's about 180 people, guests on the Ocean Endeavour, the cruise ship, it's a small ship, and we all charter up to Greenland, and it starts in Kangaroo-Sulak, which is the only place where there is an airport in Greenland right now, but it was put there for the World War II U.S. Naval Base. But Nuuk which is the capital of Greenland and Vista to the south. They are going to be building an airport too. But this is about people, the sea and ice, the landscape, and of course the wildlife. And before I went up here, I always used to wonder, how can people kayak where there's polar bears? You know, there's a lot of kayak people in our club that have paddled Labrador, and you know, what you have to go through to protect yourself is, you know, something I couldn't imagine. But it's a lot different when you're actually there, and you have a bear monitor and a zodiac following you everywhere you go, so that's a lot safer. Okay. So this is the map of where we started over here, Angeluzwa. It's a 200-kilometer fjord, and we went into a couple of places. We went a little bit south into another fjord to see a famous glacier. Went up a little bit to Simiut. I don't know if these names mean anything to you yet, but this was our path. Up in Ilulissat, when you see the pictures, that's where we get most of our icebergs from. So they travel a little bit north and come back down our coast, and it takes about 3 years by the time we see them. But that's the main production place for our icebergs. So after that, we went across the Davis Strait to Holland Inlet, Millimotalik. And then we went up through Devon Islands, Beachy Islands, and down through where John Franklin went. We saw a lot of Hudson Bay Company posts, trading posts, and Fort Ross just before the Belleat Strait, which is right here. And we went through there, which was pretty amazing. So you could see the most northerly part of the continent of North America. And then down through here to a beautiful place, so I'm told, called Joe Haven. And I was in my cabin for that day, but I was not feeling well. So I missed Joe Haven. I'll have to go again. And from there, we passed through Cambridge Bay and on to Port. There's a port here that we'll get to that port, and then on to Kapama or Kukutu. Okay, so any questions about that so far? Yeah, I know everybody loves maps, so I figured I'd put them on. Okay, so landing in Kangaluswa, down up here, and our ship waits for us here, and we just get a bus, get into our zodiacs, and board the ship, and away we go down this fjord overnight, and up we go. And this is what it looked like in the evening. Okay, so the pictures that are not really good were taken by my phone. And later on the trip, I dropped my phone in a place called Koku Bay. And so most of these pictures are taken by the professional photographers that were hired to be on board the ship for that purpose. They hire geologists, marine biologists, all kinds of specialists, botanists, and photographers, all kinds of people who can contribute to the experience of the whole trip. So a lot of these pictures are from professionals. And hopefully I'll be able to tell you which one. But this one is mine. And this is going through the fjord. We had to sneak through there. Okay, and Sakatuk should have two S's. Sorry about that. And I took this picture because it's very similar to some of the outports we travel in Newfoundland when we kayak, and I thought it was our first little stop, and it was like, wow, it made me feel a bit close to home, and I'm up in Greenland, so that was kind of good. And so, this is the top of the ship where the kayaks are stored, and this was going to be my first day, and I thought, wow, what a place to paddle. My job, of course, was to make sure all the kayaks were in good working order. Everything was, all the equipment was there and working well before. If you see in the top left corner, the big black thing sticking out is the front of the Zodiac. There's 20 of them stacked up on the top of the ship, and a big crane lifts it down to the water. So these kayaks had to be laid, like when a Zodiac is sent to the side of the ship by the crane. we load three kayaks at a time on a Zodiac, and that's how it gets down to the water. So we don't just do a steel launch from here. Okay, so after I get the gear and the kayaks, make sure they're okay, then we meet our people that are going to be on the kayak team. And there's two guys, me and one other guy. So it's 1 to 6, and 12 people stay with us for the whole journey. So it's not like anybody that wants to paddle can paddle. They have to have some experience, because you don't want to have a lot of trouble in the Arctic, right? So they have to pre-register, and they have to have some experience in the kayak. But most of these people have never been in a dry suit before. So this is how you don't put on a dry suit. Okay. This is how you rip your gaskets. But anyway, he said, when he came out of that, he said, I'm worried again. So yeah, after we dress everybody up and they're totally dying of sweat, then we load the kayaks down. So that's what it looks like going down there. And just outside after we came out of the fjord, the 200 kilometer fjord, we came a little bit south because there is a glacier fogging the gets without employees, but it means the everlasting glacier. But over the past 5 to 10 years, we're noticing how much smaller the glacier is getting. So not all of them. When you see yellow ones, they're doubles, and the red one is singles. So the guys would be in singles, so that we can, do what we have to do. And anybody that has more experience, there is a couple of other single ones if they prefer. So we can rotate that up with people that want to go. But most people come with a friend or a partner and still stay friends and partners after they've traveled in a single. Yeah, somebody had a question? Oh, okay. Yeah, this is just the group after, I bet you can recognize my hat. Yeah. Just a postcard shot of us paddling. So these mountains are about 1,200 feet high, and there's no foothills. They just come straight up out of the ocean. And you can see here the snow is starting to come down into the water. And here's the glacier front. So it's all moving down, and then as it gets to the water, it's moving out, and we witnessed a few crashes and calving of the glacier, and the waves were big, but not that big.
What distance did you see?
Oh, we were, okay, so right there, we were about at least 500 meters away from that right now. We never went very close because the waves do get quite big when it does calve, and they're calving all the time. Stay long. You can hear them crack and boom and everything as they're moving down. So, nobody was tempted to get very close. Yeah, this is just the way that we got back. So we would paddle up to the ship. This was one of the ways. And they climb into a Zodiac and then climb up into the ship there. But sometimes we would gather in the middle of the ocean somewhere, and everybody would get onto the Zodiac and then come and embark on and come to the ship that way. Likewise, there's a few different ways that we could get to where we were going. The way I showed you in those pictures where the Zodiac brought the kayaks down, and people could get down the steps in the Zodiac and into the kayak, that was one way. Sometimes the Zodiac would bring all the kayaks up to away from the ship where it's calm or whatever, where it's more convenient, and we would all be brought out by a Zodiac and get into the kayaks from the Zodiac in the middle of the ocean somewhere. And depending on where we're going, if there was a nice flat beach or flat rocks to get on, And Zodiac would bring all the kayaks to the beach, then bring all the paddlers to the beach, and then bring them back. So, depending on where we were. Yeah, there it is. There we go. So you can see that rich blue colors that I don't know if you've seen anywhere else. But this past week, I'm sure you've seen some blue tints in drift in your driveways. But where the glaciers, the pressure over the hundreds and hundreds of years compresses it down, and that's why you get the deep blue color in the glaciers. So this is moving down. And then you can see where it's kind of breaking off into like tones here, and then it just falls into the lower eventually. But this glacier, I was told by people that we were there with, that 5 years ago you couldn't see the mountain behind it. So that's how much it's shrinking. Yeah, that's just a close-up view of the most beautiful color in the world. Yeah, it's pretty amazing. And that was just after a piece of it capped off. And it made probably 1 meter waves. So, okay. So this is our first town with a population that we went to. And it's Sisimiut. And it's mostly fishing, as you can see here, to what I would call cod and crab. And there's 5,500 people there, and they were ready for us. I guess they're used to this company coming. But in one of the halls there, they had a taste of place where they had capelin and muskox and caribou and whale and seal, little chunks for people to taste. And I was brave, and I tasted some humpback whale, dried humpback whale, and it really did taste and feel like turkey. So, yeah, but I couldn't do some of that. Yeah, and also just in Sisimiut, there is a lot of kayakers, and actually when we pulled in, there was somebody doing some rolls just right outside the harbor, like there were ships and fishing boats, and one of the people there was just rolling, every different kind of roll. And the water is freezing, so. But of course, you live up there, you're going to be acclimatized. You know, our friend Noah won the award, for Jim Price Award recently. He's from Maine, and when he came down and he was doing level 3 with us, he couldn't, this was beginning of June and the water's freezing still here, and he was so warm, you know, we're bundled up trying to keep warm doing our course, he strips down to the shorts so he gets in the water to cool off, right? So, anyway, they're still making kayaks from wood frames, and they're starting to move in the school now too. Yeah, this was the guy that was rolling around, nothing better to do but roll around all day. He was probably there for an hour just rolling every different kind of roll. And you can see his tag, it completely covers him. Okay, yeah, this was part of the tried the capelin too because that was my first, you know, not so brave. Had lots of capelin before. And this is where I got brave. So, yeah, that's whale.
Was the capelin small?
Regular size, like our capelin. Yeah. They look small there, but you see the spoon, right?
Already cooked or?
No, just dried.
Oh, dried.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, they don't eat anything cooked. They just dry it so that they don't lose nutrients because they don't get as much fruits and vegetables as we would, you know, using easily get a lot more fruit and vegetables. So when you cook it, you lose some of those vitamins and minerals. And that's why just drying it, that's why they eat it that way so they can be healthier.
And that's
Yes. Yeah. That's my
pretty dry, there's no concerns with parasites at all?
I don't think so, they don't salt it, I guess it's too cold. If anybody else knows more about that, but no, they, it's just dry. And this is the next town we went, a little bit north of Invisco Bay, and it's a little set, a very big bustling little community. You can see us all kayaking in there. And fishing and tourism, that's a very popular place to go. And you'll see in the next few slides, this is where I told you that most of our icebergs come from. And it gives us 70 million tons of ice a year. And it moves at 19 to 24 meters a day. So we're standing there watching it. And if you just look, it doesn't look like it's moving, but it's just because it gets all choked up coming down through this fjord and before it releases. And where it releases is kind of shallow, so it gets really choked up until it breaks off. So next year, I'm hoping to see the ice that I saw. So here we are lowering the kayaks to go paddling just outside of Illumisat Harbor in Disco Bay. And that's our first, we got out pretty early in the morning, and that's our first sight of these. Hard to tell the size of them right now, but but they're pretty massive. So this is us in the very beginning. It looks like islands to me, but it's all completely ice. It's not snow-covered islands, it's all ice. And this is what's coming out of the fjords from a little bit. And you could hear noise, you could hear, even their little growlers, like there's ice, you know the way the iceberg sizzle in the water. For anybody that's paddled around iceberg, not too close, right? And you could hear them cracking and calving, and it'll be complete silence, and then you'll hear the big boom crashing.
What would your rule of thumb for distance away from the iceberg?
We stayed about a kilometer. We stayed about a kilometer away. It doesn't look like it, but that's a long distance. I'd say more like 800 meters away. We might have snuck in between 500 and 800, but it's just too awesome, you know, and it's too intimidating. They're huge, and you just don't want to get, I guess not with fruit, you don't want to get caught in the wave. It looks really fun to surf, but I wouldn't think of root. And, you know, it's just, you don't know how much it's going to crash, and it's just too unstable. Yeah, so this is Carroll from Soho. He's, a lot of my pictures are from this time. A lot of my pictures are from Dennis Minty, that some of you might know. He's from Twillingate, and he is responsible for starting up the San Diego Nature Park. And he's on board with us all the time as photographer and naturalist biologist. A lot of my pictures are Dennis's as well. And these whales, thank goodness for the photographers. I wasn't this close. Okay, this is a big zoom lens. But we could see them and we could hear them. And what they were doing is diving under the icebergs for the fish underneath it. So just to give you some scale, that's our, now I hope you can't read the ship because I'm not supposed to be doing stuff with a logo on you or anything. So all of you just pretend you're blurry, you can't read that way. But this is, one of the smaller chunks of ice. So just compared to the ship, you should have an idea. Yeah, there's some more whales, they were diving under the rocks. Up there. One shot, eh? Three different positions for the whales. Yeah, so this is my shot from my boat. I mean, it looks like islands, right? But
was there any birds on the iceberg?
There were. Just right now. You can see the birds up here? Right? They could be, it's hard to tell from here, but they could be fulmar, or they just could be the arctic gulls. They don't look like shavings, but, okay, so here is Ililisak right there. We came into the harbor there. And this is, all this little cluster of ice right here is what we were paddling around. So it looks like tiny there, but all those big chunks, that's where we were paddling. So then we came in and we went for a hike. As you can go out and stand out here on the edge of the cliff and have a look at all of this crazy ice. So this is where it's coming from. Cermak Kuyalek ice cap is squeezing its way into this fjord here, and it is 50 kilometers long, this fjord, and it's all just really squeezing, funneling to get out. And what's making it harder is that it's shallow just outside here, so it gets blocked up.
Is that Canada?
This is Greenland.
Okay.
Yeah. So here's the little map, right? So it's right about here. This is all Greenland, and we are right here. Right? This is me at that place where I told you where you could stand. Right there, standing on the edge of the cliff there. And just looking out at all the ice that's trying to come out of the fjord. What's that?
No gloves.
I was warm after my hike.
So this is the fall of the year, was it?
Sorry? Say again?
This was the fall of the year?
This was, yeah, from September to October. So this was late September.
Do they get snow up there that early in the year?
We had just towards like October 9th or 7th or 8th, we were starting to get some flurries. So other than that, we didn't have any snow.
What was the reason for that choice of aquifer?
Well, because it's just before all of the weather gets really bad. Like, look what we're having now, all the storms that are coming down through with the Davis Strait and Labrador Seas and everything from the Arctic, there is pretty wild right now, right? So this happens just before all of the season changes.
Is the summer pretty important, or?
They have lots of floral, lots of flowers up there in the Arctic, even at this time. Pardon?
I meant by the way.
Yes, they have a summer where there's no snow, but the ice caps are still there, and
So is this your company tour through the summer and into the fall, or do they select them?
Yep, it goes through the summer. Yeah. So they start their cruises in June and end in October. And then that ship is taken over by another company and they go to Antarctica. So
the tricky is with the Northwest Passage, it doesn't open up until once.
Because of the ice. Yeah.
Because of the ice. And this ship can't break us. It can go through ice.
It can go through sea ice, but it can't, chunky ice, and it's pretty hard. It's pretty good though. We got through some pretty thick ice, but yeah. And there were some places we couldn't go because of the ice this year.
Was there an icebreaker in the area?
No, it wasn't really necessary yet at this time of year, so. There were other ships, so we saw other cruise ships as well. We probably saw two others, but yeah, this is just another point of view. You can see the people on the edge of the cliff there, and gives you a better scale of how much ice is really there. Something else, eh? And all of that is grumbling and rolling, just really slow.
So was this picture taken by a drone, or was it taken?
No, it was taken from
a higher part of the land.
Yes.
Yeah.
Our power lines, Now, if that was here off of Portugal Cove, you'd have people out there cropping the ice pans. Yeah, this is just another shot of what it looks like. Now, this is taken from Zodiac. Not a kayak. And it's not as pleasant. So So here is kind of the scene. I added this picture because it's not really spectacular with the ice because it's close to the Lovasash Harbor. But just gives you a little bit of the scene where, you know, we're off the ship and scouting around the ice. So that's our mothership at the end of the day. And this is one example of how we got back to the ship. So we paddle up to the gangplank there and hop into the Zodiac and then hop up to the stairs.
What was the ship called?
It's a Portuguese ship. It was built in Portugal 1982, I think. I might be a little bit off.
Did you say how many days the trip was?
This one was 17 days.
17 days?
Yeah.
Any idea what people paid for you?
I can't really get into that right now.
Between 15 and 20,000.
Okay, so it's already, he said it, but
yeah, that sounds not bad. 17 days and something so long?
Yeah, you can find out the website, and there's even some of it cheaper than that and some of it more. And there's a lot of different excursions. There's into the Northwest Passage, the Northwest Passage, High Arctic, Laboratory, there's some. So this year coming up, so I told you I did Greenland, Labrador, and circumnavigate Newfoundland. This summer, this spring coming up, I'm going to be circumnavigating Newfoundland again, but also doing the Atlantic provinces, Sable Island, and Greenland. So, that's going to be cool. Yeah. Question?
Cathy, how long is the issue for the context scale with the pictures? How, do you know how long the ship is? Like how big it is,
roughly? Oh, gee.
Just to guess.
I don't want to guess.
No, fair enough. Yeah. I guess it must be 500 feet plus because it's the size of the decking and stuff.
Do you know, Neil?
I don't know. I'd say somewhere between 500 and 700 feet.
Yeah, I would say it's pretty sizable. That's for sure.
Yeah, I mean, and the kayaks and the Zodiacs are up on the ninth deck, so that's how tall it is.
Yeah. So. Thank you.
Tell you maybe how long it took me to walk from Bonestorm. This can be found out if you go on the website of Adventure Canada and all the specs of the ship and everything is on that website if you really want to find it. So you can see the ice in the back here coming out of the fjord. And this is a new museum and historical building. And this is just taken off the internet. I didn't have a picture of this, but I wanted you to see it. Because it's built to simulate snowy owl's wings in flight, and I just thought it's pretty super cool. Mm-hmm. And you can walk up over the roof, and all the history of the people is in there, and the history of the ice, and it's an excellent, excellent place. So, just wanted you to see that. Right, these guys are super important. And in the Lillisette, it's about as many sled dogs as people. And they are, some of them are roaming free, but most of them are secured in their, wherever they're owned. But the relationship that the people have with their dogs is, I don't know if anybody's familiar or met anybody with sled dogs or understand, but it's a completely different loyalty. I mean, dogs are loyal anyway, but it's really, really something, the respect that the dogs show and the people, the relationship is really something to see. And they love people. Like, there's no, I'm afraid of dogs, like new dogs, but you can just tell. Like any wildlife that you encounter, you kind of, that those first few seconds that you're checking them out and they're checking you out, you can catch the demeanor pretty quick, right? You know you're in trouble, they know they're in trouble or not. And these dogs are just amazing. The feeling that you get, the respect they have for people. So just one little funny story about when I was climbing over the roof of the museum, it was about 10 to 12 in the day, and all of a sudden the whole town lit up with the noise of all the dogs howling. And I thought, what is going on? Like, I thought it was some kind of emergency or problem. And right at 12 o'clock, silence. They all got hit. It was lunchtime. And they all got hit. Until the time, but All right, this was a real treat. When we left the Lillisette, we were making the trip right across to the north of Baffin Island, which is Pond Inlet. And that's 350-kilometer crossing. And we saw some pretty interesting things along the way. And this was one of the biggest treats because they're pretty rare, a sperm whale. And I don't know, has anybody ever seen a sperm whale? Really? Where?
Oh, well, not mine. I've seen probably what happened on the Devon through the years.
Oh.
Okay, right now, man.
Okay, that's happy.
And there was one that
recently
the same day. Right, that was the necropsy done by Jack Moss. Yeah. That might have been about maybe 8 years ago.
Yes.
The Battle of the Dragons.
Sorry, say again?
On the French head. Actually, the spiders are taking back the fall.
Yeah.
The sperm whales are falling.
Wow, cool. Well, they're pretty huge. They can be between 16 and 24 meters long and about 50 tons. And one third of their body is their head. And they're the creature on Earth that has the largest brain. So this is the creature that has the largest brain that anybody has ever encountered. So, but the blue whale, of course, is bigger by three times, but not in great. So that was a treat. We were just watching that off the side of the ship.
How close were you to?
I would say 100 meters.
Oh, excellent.
Yeah, it was pretty close. And you can tell them by the 45-degree angle spout, too. And also, right here, you can see the kind of ribby kind of texture on his back. That's a good identifier for them as well. And this little hump, if he comes up a little bit more, you'll see a series of little other small humps on his back. So that's the giveaway for us. Here he is. Look, see the ribs there? Can you see? Yeah, so he was playing around there for quite a while. And there was, you can see the roughness of the texture of his back. Alright, so we got across, we knew there was a storm coming when we had to cross from the Lillisette to Battle Island. These were the clouds that we saw from the Lillisette before we left. And we knew there was trouble, right? So we had to, get across before the storm. And this was, so here's a Lillisette, and this was the storm that was coming up, and we had to go up into here, into Pond Inlet. And we managed to stay just ahead of the storm. And when we looked at Windy while we were there, the ship was just staying just right ahead of the storm. So that was pretty good. That was a bad one. So this is Pond Inlet. And it was absolutely beautiful. Nobody said they were there before, just one person. Okay. Yeah. So it was very welcoming, population 1600-ish. And it's fishing, tourism, some wage jobs, like there's a grocery store there, and there's a bank, and that kind of stuff, and school, and there's a supply ship that comes up to Pond Inlet once a year, and that's it. So whatever the community needs, for the grocery store, money for the bank, any supplies, hardware supplies, tools, anything, medicine, that's it. It's a one-shot deal. Comes up in the ship. They get it for 1 year. So we were kind of torn. We wanted to spend some money there and support the community, but we didn't want to take their supplies. Right? So it was a bit tricky. So what we did instead is we bought a lot of their art, which was a good compliment. But they had a really nice welcoming for us when we were there. And it was excellent to, very first right off the ship, we landed off the Zodiacs. And they were ready for us, right, just sitting on the side of the hill cooking tea and had little treats for us, yeah. And very happy and proud to show us their traditional clothing, talk to us and teach us a few words. And this is a traditional welcoming ceremony where they have this lamp that's lit by seal oil, and it's a very skilled thing that the women do, where they just use as much oil as they need to use, so they're constantly just feeding the fire with just as much oil as it needs to preserve the oil so they don't waste anything. It's quite amazing. So they put off, we went to the school gym, and there was families there, and young children of the community, and they sang for us, and danced for us, and invited us to participate in some of their Arctic games and challenges, and they were quite something. There was one I don't have a picture of, where you put your hand around your friend, you poke your finger into their mouth while they are poking their finger into your mouth, right? And a lot of the games are to test your strength and to make you strong. And they'll pull until one person hits. And just to make you strong. Or another one is where they would twist a knuckle, because they need their hands to be strong for all the work they do in the cold. And they twist each other's knuckles until one of them hits. Just to strengthen. And so many things they did, crawling on the floor on their toes and fingers in a plank position. Like, can anybody want to try? they would always do it with good spirit and fun and competition to help each other get strong for what they have to do. But this was a beautiful presentation. And you see that little seal up there? This is one of the games. They would have to start sitting on the ground, and one hand has to stay on the ground when they jump to kick for the seal, and they keep raising the seal as it happens. And all kinds of little challenges like that. It was really cool to see. And this is adorable mom and daughter, and they're showing their pride in Nunavut becoming its own province since 1999. And The red in the Inukshuk is representing Canada, and the white, the yellow and the blue is for the land and sea that provides for them, and the star is the North Star, and of course the white is the ice. And they're showing it and explaining it all to us. And then from Honda, we moved on to Cook Bay, which is on Devon Island. We're going more north. It's just above Devon Island. And here's a glacier face that was about 4 kilometers long, what we were looking at. And I guess the height, I don't know. I can't guess the height. Well, some of the pictures, if you can guess the height. I just, I couldn't resist putting this in, because we got to Croker Bay in early morning in the fog, and we had to disembark. You can see down here at the bottom, there's Zodiac right here with the kayaks on it. Can you see it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so this is my biggest fear whenever I'm paddling in the fog, that a ship like this is going to disappear. Anybody else have that? Paddling in the fog and I know a ship face is just going to come right up. But anyway, that's what this means for me. So out of the fog, we started to paddle towards the end of that glacier. And as you can see, the ice cap is moving down into the water there. And here's a beautiful Tony Reiner is another photographer that took this, and you can see the fog on top of the ice. So the picture that you saw either on Facebook or advertising for this, these are the. This is the ice that's behind the kayakers that, you know, it's pretty nice. We didn't get very close. They were breaking off a lot. And That's the one. So we're really about 500 meters away there. So whatever camera, whoever knows photography, how you're going to. Go on. And this is on our way back to the ship. I just thought that was pretty gorgeous. There's lots of ice chunks and dog was lifting. And this guy, this is where I dropped my phone. Okay, from the Poker Bay. I always have my phone attached. I always have everything attached to me. Nothing is free because we all lose them, right? But of course, there's always that one incident where I took my phone off to take a picture of the ice, and somebody asked me if they could use my pump to get the ice, to get the water out of their boat. So I just tucked my phone into my life jacket, just for a second, right? And to get my pump, I had to really twist around to the back. It was behind my seat, so of course my phone pops out. I felt really bad because I littered in the Arctic. But then somebody told me in 40 years it'll be an artifact, so it's okay. But shortly after that happened, this guy came up. I'm sure he was like, what the heck is that? That doesn't taste good, I don't know. But when he came up, you can't really tell, but he came up really slow, and his head was so big, I thought it was going to be a walrus, so I was getting ready to call our Zodiac driver to come, because I thought, oh my gosh, if this is a walrus, we're out here. But, I mean, we see a lot of seals in our waters when we paddle, but this guy was really big. And anybody want to take a guess what kind of seal it is?
Beard.
Yes.
What's
that
beard? What size is the
head? Oh, like what size?
Yeah, like.
Okay, give you an idea. Okay, so if you compare a yellow seal.
Your gray seal?
Yeah, no, like we have harbor seals, a lot of harbor seals here. And like if you compare the size of his head to a Newfoundland dog. Like, this head was coming up, I'd say, about the size of a Newfoundland dog. And I thought, how big is he underneath? And this is the same guy looking, it doesn't look like the same guy, but it did look like the same. But you know what I found strange, like, we were kind of close to him, because he was curious, but what I found cool about the interaction looking at this guy was, first I thought, but after that, it was like seals are used to being hunted up there. And I mean, I don't know about you, but when we're paddling, we see a lot of seals face to face, eye to eye, and you make that contact, and they're checking you out, and they're checking them out. And they're here in our waters, they're just curious, sometimes playful, sometimes come really close to your boat, no fear, right? But the look on this guy was like, you know, you could tell that there's a different experience from the seals just by the way he was looking at us. And I thought, wow, it was kind of a neat thing. You don't have to speak. You know?
He looks like he's asking for your hat's cold.
Want to take a selfie? So this is absolutely a beautiful. This was a cruise. We went down through here, Devon Island Ice Fjord, and absolutely still, quiet, monster mountains beside us. And obviously, the color of the water makes for amazing reflections. And everybody was just out on deck in awe, just moving through this fjord, to this pristine, untouched, beautiful, magnificent, historical. And there was just we're running out of words of how beautiful it was. And, you know, the thin, cool air and the quiet, it was quite an awesome experience. And I know it's not paddling, but I got there because of that, so I can talk to you. But we did get out. We did get out and paddle, but only for a short time because there were polar bear and brown bear. So we could stay up.
Did you get up to the land that might help?
Not here because of the bears, but there are some, you'll see some places where we did. But the highlight of this trip, like, that's absolutely stunning, right? And you can see the ship right here. So, you know, this was just miles and miles of absolute. So then we came across this guy, and it's another bearded seal. And this was towards the, getting towards the end of this ice fjord in Devon Island that we were at, that we were cruising up through. He was just pretty full and tired and just curious about us. And I mean, it's magnificent. This is what we were sailing past. It was just breathtaking. And this was a highlight. At the end of this little ice fjord, I'm sorry that it's a bit blurry. It is a really good picture. I just blew it up to make sure you could see that the horn of the narwhal. And we saw about, there was probably 30 narwhals just rolling around and doing their thing. And we just, the marine biologist on board was out of her mind. She was like, we've never seen this. This is really rare. So we watched for quite a while. It's very short. And this is a drone, so it's no rare bird. It's just a drone. So then from Devon Island, we moved on to Prince Leopold Island. And very distinctive layers of rock and silts at the bottom. And Prince Leopold Island is a bird sanctuary, and you are supposed to stay 5 kilometers away. It has a buffer of 5 kilometers, but there is a port where we could land. But this is just some of the amazing places you could never go to, kind of look. This is a little waterfall stream coming down from, I guess, the snow there, but this is the store of the Leopold Island. So, along these, this is our first white buddy. So, see these rocks here? They're pretty steep, right? And we see this tiny little, everybody's eyes were peeled. It's like, we haven't seen a polar bear yet. Everybody's eyes are peeled, and you're almost making the little white rocks move. You want to see a polar bear, so that. But going along the side of the cliff, we saw this polar bear moving, and the rocks were tumbling. It was so steep. The rocks were tumbling from his feet, and he was slipping a little bit, he was moving along, and we were all kind of worried because he was about 300 feet up there, and we thought that he might have a tumble into the ocean. But he found this little cave and stopped to look at us and watched us for about 20 minutes, and then he went inside the cave and had rest. So he was our show, and we were his show. And this is just a picture of how steep was. And fulmar is a very common bird at that island, but also fulmars are always following the ship. And they play around and swarm around and follow the wake of the ship, the ship and the wind of the ship. But this is what it looks like from the ground. And lots of murres there. Wherever you come from, however you say it, Mars or Tris. So these are some of the birds that we saw. They also have fires, anyway. Parasitic dagger, did anybody ever hear that one? And Grumpus skulls. But we didn't see all of them. On my last trip just recently, coming down from Greenland down the Labrador coast, we saw a short-eared snowy owl and some peregrine falcons and a little bit more gray, but what's the next? So, Port Leopold, it was a place that we could land. We got off the ship and came to land for a hike. And you can see here, ancient ruins of a house that the Thule lived in, and they are the ancestors of the Inuit. And you can, to walk around there was just amazing because you could see could see, you know, the artifacts of how they lived. All these bones, you know, around the houses, there'd be ribs of whales and luna heads and, you know, how they lived and ate. It was right there in front of us. And there was a, as you walked around, there'd be a really small door where they would enter the house. And, you know, you could see how, even now, later, this way, you could see. But, you know, it was very strict not to move stone, not to touch anything, not to change anything. But it was quite fascinating. And also on these islands, wherever we went, whether it was by kayak or by ship or whatever, wherever these little ancient communities were, there was also grave sites. And we had an Inuit interpreter on board with us that would come around and help everybody understand where to go and where not to go, and what everything meant and how these houses were built. And that was quite fascinating.
Did everybody get off the ship?
Yeah, everybody. I mean, if you didn't want to, you didn't have to, but everybody did. You know, not 100% of the time. Depending, I mean, this was 2 years ago, and there was some COVID going around on the ship, and there were some people sick, and, you know, so if you could choose to stay on the ship if you didn't want to get out, but I mean, they're there to experience, so if you could go, then you could.
How many people were on the
Passengers, 180. Staff, expedition team, 30. And crew, staff, another 30.
So what did everybody else do, Cathy, that wasn't kayaking?
Oh, if they weren't kayaking, they would just be doing the hikes or a Zodiac tour. But when we kayak, we would go for maybe 2 hours, 2.5 hours, maybe three, a couple times. And then they'd have the option to continue on the hikes or explore the land for the afternoon or for the rest of the day. So they kind of got the best of both worlds. Yeah, this is just the center of a vertebrae of a whale. I should have asked you if you knew. And just to prove that there can be flowers that grow in cold up there, this is an Arctic poppy. But we have the purple, you know, the purple saxifrage, like little. Bells. We have a lot of bells flowers there. Now, here we get to Beachy Island, where anybody know what this is about? Yeah. So these gravestones here, these tombstones are not real graves. There's nobody there. They're just memorials. The bodies were found by a scientist back in the 82 or something, and shown to be the died of TB and you know, close to that as well. But this is the last post that they understood where Franklin was. And there have been like over 100 expeditions of people that tried to find Franklin and his crew. There was 129 on the Terror of the Airless, the ship setting up. And they were all lost. So there was a lot of expeditions after that, trying to find them. So this used to be what was the Northumberland House, which became a place where people would come and stay and set up camp while they were looking for Franklin's. All of these barrel braces for all their supplies. I found this interesting because this is like the boom and the mast of a sail ship that was just an artifact there on the beach from one of the expedition ships that tried to find Franklin. Some of those expedition ships made it and some of them didn't. And Randy, you know, there's some of us in the group that like to find hearts in the rocks and things. And this is a bit blurry, but it is a little fossil. I don't know what it is, but I thought it was quite interesting. Ah! Oh, onward, we went down to Port Ross, one of the Hudson Bay company trading posts. It was set up in 1937 and only lasted for 11 years. And you could look inside of those, and the polar bears have definitely taken up shelter there and picked out whatever they could pick out. But you can see us kayaking over here. Yes, over here. So this was very different. You can see the landscape is a lot flatter and a lot of loose rocks and silt and sand, very different. So we had a windy but a very good paddle here. So that's just looking at it from the kayak. Oh, put this in because this is the pool on the ship, and we were very cold after our paddle. And this pool is not always filled, of course. When you're sailing, they don't have it in there, but it's just seawater. And we were all thinking it was going to be freezing because it was seawater, but it's actually filtered and it cools the engine, and the engine warms the water of the boat. So we said, let's just keep on our dry suits. It's going to be freezing. Let's jump in with our dry suits on. And it was like a warm swimming pool. We were practicing some safety maneuvers here. So just, I guess way over here, way over here would have been Port Ross, where we just came from. And coming south and turning west, we're coming into the Belleau Strait. And it's named after a French guy, Joseph René Belleau, who was sledding with Canadian discoverer William Kennedy. And they discovered that the north part was actually Somerset. It was an island, Somerset Island, because they did not know that you could pass right through. So it was 1852 when they discovered that you could actually pass through between the North American continent and Somerset Island. So many ships tried to get through, and it would be ice blocked, or they didn't all think to get through. It's only 2 kilometers wide and 25 kilometers long. So. And right here, you see this little point here? That is actually the most northerly point of North America, of the continent. So that's a cool place. And somebody asked about a ship. That was another cruise ship coming through. All right, on to Cunningham Bay, which is southeast of Prince of Wales Island. I don't know if you know where that is, but I can show you back at the map here. But this is a very famous place where belugas migrate every year. We were not there at the time. We were like a month late for when the belugas would have been there. And they come in the hundreds, the belugas do. And that's why the we knew we would find polar bears. Because the polar bears are there to fish them. There's seals and everything there. So you can see there's a carcass right here on the beach, a beluga carcass. And as we were, we went by Zodiac here because we knew there would be high risk of polar bear. And sure enough, here he comes. And we're about 200 meters offshore there. And if you can see, his mouth is open. When a polar bear is threatened or is feeling aggressive, you might have seen them on TV, you know, their heads kind of go side to side and they're making growling noise. That's they're feeling threatened, and you should feel threatened too if you see them doing that. And when he first saw us, of course, not knowing if we're fit to eat or if we're dangerous, this is how he was approaching where he could see us. Head was rolling, it was quite something to see, very powerful. And as he got up to us, it was no big deal. Like, you guys are boring. So it was a female. They determined it was a female. And the way they determined that is because the back of her legs were yellow, and that's how she moved. And so she just stopped to have a look at us, and we were stopped to have a look at her. And so she sat down, got comfortable, just left us for a while, and got super comfortable. We were just having a stare down, watching each other, fascinated by each other.
What distance were you at?
About 200 meters offshore. So we were using binoculars and, you know, these were done by, you know, you could see her very well, but to take pictures you needed a big camera. So we were entertained by a show. And everywhere, not everywhere, but it's very common to find an Arctic fox wherever you see photographs, because they get the seconds, right? They're the second keepers off of where the photographers catch. So the photographers are hunting for the foxes, really. And when they're done, he's actually feeding on a skull of a bluebear. And he was really close to that polar bear. And polar bears are used to the foxes being around them. You know, it's how they live. This is Port Epworth, which is, I took this picture because this was a day I was sick after Geova Haven. Geova Haven, I hope to go back there sometime so I can see over here, but this is Port Epworth, it's about halfway between Geova Haven and Cockermine. It was our last stop before Cockermine. And just wanted you to see how it looks kind of springish, and there was all colors and flowers and all kinds of vegetation there. But I was the only one that stayed back on the ship, and I had a great time. I went to the sauna. So they had a great hike, and I had a great time on the ship. So the last thing I want to say, I think it's the last thing. Mark St. Ange, I don't know if any of you are geologists, but you might know him, he's very famous. And he's known for discovering the oldest rock in the world. And he found it in the Coppermine area. And it's that's pronounced gneiss, if anybody knows who that was. And it's 4.5 billion years old. And he had a sample of all of these things. And he's quite a fun and excited guy about the rock. So I thought that was pretty fun. This is my crew that we have on the kayak. So, in that trip, we were looking all the time for the northern lights, but didn't see them. But this recent one that I just went on, we had an excellent display of the northern lights. And if anybody has ever seen them, it's always been in the distance, right? But this was taken like 1 o'clock in the morning on the top deck of the ship, like we were under them. And it was just incredible. They're moving all around the sky and, you know, changing colors and moving around. And this one in particular, underneath here, we were standing on the ship and looking up through the hollow of the lights. Like it was right over us. It's just the most amazing experience. So that's it for me. So. Hopefully next time I can tell you some more about Greenland and Labrador and the Torngat Mountains and the places we went.
Quite a trip, anyway. Yeah. If you want to go live up north, you won't need a Woodstone. But he's my father used to say, woodpecker would have a pack of lunch. Anyway, Cathy, thank you very much for the presentation and hopefully the introduction. So, on behalf of Paddle Newfoundland and Labrador, we just want to give you a little bit of power. Appreciate you. And then, next presentation will be on March 6th. There will be an email coming out about that, and that will be tomorrow night. And then the next one will be 2 weeks after that, on March 20th. I don't know if there's getting more lined up after that, but we'll let you know. Anyway, thanks for coming, folks.